Hey everybody, welcome back to another edition of Awaken the Wonder. I'm excited to continue my conversation with Gary Beaton for part three, and you're going to hear from him in just a moment. Before you do, I just want to remind you guys right off the top, make sure you subscribe. You can leave a turn on the notification bell on YouTube, and then on the Awaken the Wonder podcast, make sure you leave a rating and a review for us. It'll help us in the algorithms. And I'm really excited to welcome back Gary here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Caleb.
Our first couple of conversations here have been pretty fun, huh?
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah. So make sure you go back to the last two episodes. You're going to hear part one and part two of our conversation. In this specific one, I want to focus on prophetic assignments or prophetic journeys. Now, to some in the audience, they may say, well, what's that? You know, what's a prophetic assignment or a prophetic journey? And oftentimes the Lord will begin to prompt our hearts, and because he's working out a greater degree of obedience in us, he wants us to go to another level of hearing his voice. But also because there's specific things he's wanting to do in people's lives and families and generations and in countries, nations, cities, whatever it may be. And you have, while I've had a few myself that have been part of my journey of learning obedience, you've had a number of these over the years, which are not just like, you know, go to the gas station and stand on the corner or something. Like, you've had like things that have changed your family tree, the things that have really changed your legacy and family, and they've been powerful. So I'm looking forward to hearing your journey today. How did your journey of learning to hear God's voice begin?
Wow. Well, that, it really started really just in that call as an intercessor. Just calling me into the secret place to be with him and to know I'm an intercessor, to be a prayer warrior, to stand in the gap and to call in what the Father wants called in. Mm-hmm. What's on the Father's heart? What does he want for the kingdom? It's his kingdom. You know, what's your will? What do you want to do today? Or what do you want to do in what do you want me to do? How do I fit in the bigger picture? How can I pray your heart? How can I pray your will into being? How can I help bring a manifestation of your will in any dimension? But as I just drew in closer to him, you know, I have always just had a prolific dream life. So he began really speaking to me in dreams and in all through the 90s. And it's when I met John Paul Jackson for the first time, and he was amazing. He was one of the earliest and one of the most foremost teacher on dream interpretation. So in getting to know him and then going through his courses multiple times personally in person, and just being trained by him, being trained by a lot of them, and getting all the books on definitions. The Lord doesn't even necessarily use the same symbols, but just having an interesting a pursuit to hear the voice of God, and that he can speak through dreams and visions and trances. He can speak with a still small voice. He speaks when we read the word, just as we meditate on the word, revelation will come, you know.
What would you say to the person maybe that they're having dreams, maybe they had a vision, maybe they even felt a prompting, but they're like, oh, I probably just made that up, or oh, this is it. The dream didn't make any sense. It couldn't mean anything.
Yeah. You know? Well, I think it's just pursuing it more and asking the Lord for confirmations. He wants us to hear his voice. That's one thing. We need to have faith and be encouraged that he wants us to know him. He wants us to hear his voice and to get to know that voice. He said, my sheep know my voice and they follow me. So we get familiar with that over time. He will give us our own language. You know, I may hear him. He has a language I begin to learn from him that will be the way I hear him. And I develop that over time because I'll invest time in understanding, trying to understand how to interpret my dreams. Because he said, in Proverbs 25:2, that it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, the glory of kings to search it out. So there's a glory on it of us pursuing and searching out the riddles. And so he often speaks in dark speech, he says, in Job. And dreams in the night are dark speech. Right. They're meant to be riddles, so that we have to be on a pursuit like a treasure hunt. And I love that part about him, because I think we all love puzzles or mysteries or treasure hunts. When I was a kid, I know I loved treasure hunts. And whatever that meant to help solve the riddles or solve the clues, he'd give you a little bit more, a little bit more. So to me, it's always been that way, is show me what this means. I want to know you. Daniel, the prophet Daniel, excelled at this. And the young guys, he excelled at dream interpretation. He had a gift and he had an excellent spirit. So I asked the Lord through the years, Lord, I want to have an excellent spirit.
Wow, that's really good.
I want to be like you. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be someone you groom to get to know you and hear your voice. And so speak to me in the multiple ways, and even hearing the audible voice. And I want to hear however you want to speak, but help me get it so I can solve what needs to be solved and be about your will.
Now, through that, through your journey of hearing his voice, and I think many people can connect to that because they're trying to hear God's voice.
Right.
The part there might be like, well, what's a prophetic assignment? You know, like, how does that look like? Or what does it look like? You've had ones that have like layers to them, you know?
Right.
And now one of them that come to mind is with your family tree. You went to Scotland.
Right.
Tell me about Scotland.
Right. Okay. That was one of the first ones I had ever been on. I didn't know what a prophetic journey was, or I never knew anything about intercessory journeys or identification or repentance, or I didn't have any grid because there were no books on it when I started. So I had to kind of learn it. And it started with a prompting or an unction, just a stirring in my spirit. You know, the thought will cross your mind or something will provoke you. You may read something and a thought will come to you that you didn't think of, and you may think, well, that's just me, but the Lord will confirm it. He'll come back and he'll maybe come at you two or three different ways to begin revealing himself and maybe how he wants you to go do something. So he began speaking to me about Scotland in January, 1 year, almost 20 years ago. He began speaking to me early that year about going to Scotland because I had learned in my family history that there were two archbishops in Scotland with the name of Beaton, James Beaton and David Beaton, in the early 1500s that were Catholic archbishops, and they controlled the religion. They were so powerful in Scotland at the time, and it was early in the Reformation. They had all power. So as the Protestant Reformation began evolving, the Catholic Church looked at it as rebellion, Protestants. Mm-hmm. We were protesting. We were Protestants.
Yeah.
And so they had to put an end to the rebellion. And their way was very cruel. They began burning believers at the stake in Scotland and England. And many were being martyred for their faith, just as Protestants in our differences. And so turns out that these two Catholic cardinals, archbishops in my family line, had literally been in power in 1528 and 1546 to burn hundreds of Protestant reformers at the stake. When I learned that in my family history, I was broken. I mean, I was grieved. There's a grief that came on me. What can I do about that? I mean, it's just a terrible blight on my family name and my line. Just that the grief of that even happened to believers that were genuine, who were pure, who just wanted the Lord. And I didn't know what to do about it. The Lord knew I was grieved. Now, I knew about this for some years before he ever began speaking to me about what I could do. You may be getting the stirrings of maybe being sent on a prophetic journey way before you do it. A lot of times there's time built in where he's calling you to it, and you need time to do research, time to sort it out. You don't just go on these like quick, you know, unless he sends you somewhere right now. But these usually take time to plot out, and you know, so that you know.
So if somebody's feeling a stirring, take note, start to write the things down, and steward the thought.
Right.
Search it out.
Right.
What could this mean? Well, like, what type of things could you be looking for? Could it be dates or times or seasons or histories or meanings? Or like, what type of things can people be looking for if they're feeling a stirring?
Right. And so I had to learn that there's like a protocol to it. And there's a pattern of generally how certain things can go. He is God Almighty. So he's, you know, he's a God of creation. So he's very creative. And so there's not a formula, but there's a way he goes about it, about the promptings and speaking. And so early out, he began speaking to me, and I'll make notes of it in my journal, maybe, or I'll just keep that thought in my heart. So I just have the stirrings in my heart. And it may be way out, but I'm okay. I'm patient. I don't want to go somewhere and do something unless he's in it. Unless he sends me, I don't want to go. I don't want to make something up on my own to think I'm doing something for God. I don't need to do that. I only want to be sent because he sends me.
Wow.
And in the sending, there's authority. In the sending, there's the breaker.
Wow.
In the sending, there's power to operate in his power, because he's ordaining you to go. He's commissioning you to go. So it's a high calling in a way. It's in secret. So it's not like you're going telling a bunch of people stuff. You've got to be trained like a Navy SEAL. You've got to be, it's a covert operation in a way. You keep the secret things of the Lord. You've got to be able to keep the secrets. And he trusts us with the secrets of God, the mysteries of the kingdom, a lot of times as intercessors. And we've got to live up to that and only be saying what he wants us to say. For years, I never even told stories at all, because they were secret things, and I wanted to honor him in that. So, but he was speaking to me about going to Scotland this year, and I'm like, what is that? You know, generally, he always wants to send you to a geographic location. There's something about travel in it where he wants you to go to a place. So that's one thing that kind of is always there. You can pray and intercede from a distance. I'm not taking anything away from that. Things happen just when you pray for any nation.
But talking about when there's
a personal
specific assignment, right?
Yes, he'll send you somewhere. And it usually has to do with something that happened in history, something related to a date, and something that took place in time where something happened because of sin, because of decisions of men, or people gave in to the enemy. And it'll say in a region, men sinned, and it allowed the enemy to make a stronghold in that area. It allowed the enemy to make strongholds over a city because the sins that men agreed on or made covenant in a city. So they're allowed, the enemy is allowed to have dominion, because we forfeit our dominion when we sin as men. We forfeit, we abdicate our authority to dark powers. If we say join some fraternal club that's dark, a secret society that's not of God, we can be making vows to some other gods, not even knowing what we're doing. And so a lot of times people have surrendered their authority to dark powers and don't even know it. And so whatever, there's something that took place in time, what I called, that caused a tear in the fabric of time, that where sin came in and allowed something dark to happen. We can stand in the gap And I can, through identificational repentance, I'm vested in this because they were members of my family, Whoa. My family name. So I had the authority to be sent to Scotland in the lineage, generationally, to that castle in St. Andrews, Scotland, to where this happened in the 1500s, where they burnt Protestants at the stake. And the Lord's saying, go to St. Andrews. And I'm like, and take communion and repent, you know, to enter into that grieving, what took place, and sob and weep and enter into that place of repentance before the Lord, that He would cleanse out that whole thing as though it never happened. Put the blood on it and cleanse away that sin from Scotland. Cleanse away that sin from my family name. Cleanse away that sin in other people's lives. Wow. And it lifts guilt off of Scotland. It'll lift guilt and shame and all kinds of stuff that's been there maybe for centuries. It can cause something to break open. So I'd never been on one. This is my first one. He's telling me, I want you to go to Scotland. And I'll go, I'll obey you. But I've never done this. Just get a ticket, go to Scotland and repent. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm famous for the Lord. I don't know what I'm doing. And he says, it's okay. I know what I'm doing. And so just follow me. So I told him, you know, he's telling me, I want you to go to Scotland, get your ticket. And I'm like, I'd been sort of putting it off. And it finally came down to 2 weeks out in this April. And it's in March. And I said, man, I got to get my ticket, my plane ticket. And it was a Sunday afternoon. I needed to buy my ticket that day. And I told the Lord, if you want me to go to Scotland, then you need to give me a dream this afternoon. So I know you want me to go to Scotland. Because I'm not sure I'm hearing right. And I don't put the Lord to the test. I don't lay out a bunch of fleeces ever. But this one day, I needed to know something. Yeah. So I go to sleep that afternoon in a nap. And I suddenly, in my dream, I'm back in time. In Scotland. And it's 1543 back in Scotland. I'm in Scotland in 1543. And I'm standing in someone's home. And I know, you just know stuff in dreams. I knew I'm in this lady's home. She had my name. Her name is Heather Beaton. And I know I'm in Heather Beaton's living room in this home in Scotland, in this village in 1543. And she's not there. I'm just standing in her little living room with a hearth, fireplace. And she comes in the door with her brother. And in the dream, I'm standing there. And she goes, what are you doing in my home? And I didn't know what to say. I was on the spot. I said, I'm from the future. I said, I'm from the future. The Lord sent me. That's all I could think of. The Lord sent me. This is crazy. But she said, okay, if the Lord sent you, then I'm going to get my Tyndale Bible off the shelf. And I'm going to open up across the room here. You're going to tell me what I've written in the margin of my Tyndale Bible. Wow. And I'm like, with a word of knowledge, I'm like, what? So she opened it up. She's across the room from me. And I'm supposed to have a word of knowledge that can see that page. And I close my eyes and the words begin to develop, you know, on the page in my sight where I'm going to, they're going to come into focus and I can tell her what's on the page. And I wake up. I wake up and I'm like, I was just at the moment where I could tell her. And I wake up. But the first thing I said is, I'm going to Scotland. You know, I know that I know.
You got a clear direction from the Lord. It was time. Right. Let's go to Scotland.
Right. So it turned out, like, what was in the dream? What clues are in the dream that confirm it? Well, I didn't know anything about William Tyndale, but the Tyndale Bible came up in the dream. I Googled that afternoon, William Tyndale. Sure enough, he translated a New Testament that was called the Commoner's Bible. Mm. And they were smuggled into England in her lifetime.
Wow.
starting in 1535. And she would have had, she could have had one. She could have had a Tyndale Bible.
Wow.
And of all things, it was William Tyndale, and that Bible, which I knew nothing about, was the confirming evidence that dream was from God.
Come on.
And so, yeah, I bought my ticket that afternoon.
Wow.
And 2 weeks later, here I'm on my way, and I flew to Scotland and went to St. Andrews and, you know, got a room. And everyone goes to St. Andrews to go golfing as the golf capital of the world, you know, but I'm going there to pray. And it ended up just being an incredible experience in the Lord, going and kneeling down in the cobblestone, 6 a.m. at twilight in the morning, on the cobblestone where the Protestants' names are in the cobblestone. Their initials are in the cobblestone where they were burnt at the stake. And I knelt down with communion and just wept. I'm all by myself.
Wow.
In this little town in Scotland, by myself, taking communion, weeping for what my ancestors had done. And I entered a place in the spirit where the Lord allowed me, as though I was back in time, to hear their cries and that suffering of being burned at the stake, and calling out to the Lord to have mercy, cleanse all that, and what took place in the Reformation, not only for Scotland, but for everyone that was martyred, both sides. So, I mean, that just began a journey for me, which has taken me to so many nations and crisscrossing America dozens of times and
that
hundreds and hundreds.
Fascinating. Wow, that's fascinating. And for those listening, they're probably, most of them maybe have never heard anything like this.
Yeah, it's unusual.
If the Lord were awakening something in them today to take a step, I mean, what would be some signs that they could be looking for in their dreams, their thoughts, or like, I don't know why, like some of them might say, well, I keep hearing about Japan or something, or, you know, I keep seeing 11:11 on the clock, or, you know, like there might be things like that people might mention. But what would you say to somebody that's like, I'm trying to search for, like, I feel like there's something going on, I just can't put a finger on it.
Yeah, you know? No, that's good. I would just believe in the prophetic realm and the revelatory realms as intercessors, and just walking with the Lord. He speaks in patterns. You know, that's one thing. He does speak in patterns. So we will see numbers. We will see repeated numbers that mean something. They can be scriptures, 11:11. You can search out scriptures anytime he's speaking to you about that. But I would ask the Lord, you know, Lord, is there something you want me to do? Is there something you want, somewhere you want me to go for you to stand in the gap? To repair a breach, you know, in Isaiah 58, it speaks about us being repairers of the breach.
Wow.
Well, that's what one of the ways there's a breach is the breach caused by sin.
Yeah.
That we can go and repair a breach through repentance and taking the blood and covering it, in a sense. Wow. And so we are priests that can weep between the porch and the altar. And we go before the Lord and can take the power of the blood and his desires to pour mercy and cleansing out, and even healing for nations.
Wow.
Healing for families. Just, God, I want to be an instrument of healing.
Yeah.
I want to be an instrument of redemption. You're the Redeemer. You called us to be Redeemers. And so use me as a Redeemer, whether I lead people to Christ or whether I can do these things in secret for you.
Yeah.
Begin teaching me and training me, equip me in this. And so, yeah, there's things he taught me through the years, and things he taught me on you've got to do research. Once he begins speaking to you about a place or an event in history in your family, or maybe something in American history or some other nation, it caused a major grief. The Lord has specialized assignments, I believe, for every one of us.
Yeah.
That he'll begin speaking to you about. And if you're willing, he will make it abundantly clear. You won't be able to get away from it, because he will start speaking about that region and maybe a name in history. Or you, then once you begin to get a stirring, then you start doing research.
Yeah.
What happened in this city during this time? Who was involved? and you have to be a detective. He'll start giving you clues, and if you'll put the time in, he'll honor that to start doing the research to find out why he wants to send you somewhere. You're willing, but he'll begin making it clear.
I do believe there's people listening today that they've been, this is the confirmation they've been waiting for, because this isn't the kind of thing you just turn on and hear somewhere,
right.
You know, like
right.
They might have been following this podcast because they're, hey, there's a miracle or a healing, but like, they're like, what is this today? This is what I've been waiting for. I haven't heard anything like this. So I think this is going to be encouraging. I would be remiss not to ask you. So as a result of going there, mm-hmm. You know, I know there's been dozens of these, but for like maybe this specific one, you're in Scotland, you come home. Now you're a month down the road, 2 months down the road, a year down the road. What do you think happened as a result of you taking that act? Obviously, you obeyed the Lord, but was there something in your family tree that was righted? Have you had been more blessed because of your decision? Or you know what I mean? How can people trace maybe that there's been fruit from this?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's true. In every single journey, you may find out then. You may know something then as a confirmation. He'll generally give you something to confirm along the way, but definitely as a marker when you're done, so you know something. He's good about that. He always will give me a marker. What's funny is, well, that morning, this is how it kind of wrapped up for me. It turned out to be a Good Friday morning in this little town in Scotland, this village in St. Andrews. I'm all alone down in this little village square. And the sun is beginning to come up. I've just wept my eyes out and cried out to God to see something happen to bring redemption and cleansing from the Reformation. And man, I poured out everything in me. And the sun's coming up. I'm all by myself. I'm all alone. I'm thinking, this kind of feels anticlimactic, you know? Like, what now? Okay, I go home, you know? Because you have real feelings.
It's a long plane ride from Scotland to
right,
the U.S.
Right. And so, you know, I don't know, but I felt prompted to take the steps. They have the steel staircases that go down to the rocky beach. And I just felt prompted, as long as I'm here in these castle ruins looking down at the water, I'll go down to the water. I just follow that prompting. What's wild is that I went down the steps and I'm walking along the shore with the sand and the rocks, and I came on this ledge of rocks, and I looked down and I couldn't believe it. There are three oval stones laid there by somebody. There are three little oval stones, and the water's crashing on the rocks. Three little oval stones, and the stone in the center is etched. They're slate stones on the shore. The stone in the center has the cross etched in it. Mm-hmm. And the two on each side, the two ovals next to the cross, are two fish, the sign of the fish from way back as in Christendom, as the sign of the fish. So there's two fish ovals next to the cross. And they were the two, I believe, a sign of the two guys I went to stand in the gap for,
wow.
Patrick Hamilton in 1528 and George Wycliffe in 1546. They were the two martyrs I went to repent for.
Wow.
And God, something was childlike, but I knew, I started crying when I see these, a little kid or an angel had set these on this, who's going to be down on the beach and set these here for any reason?
Yeah.
There's no reason at all. It's that God wanted me to find that as in a childlike way, as a marker, as a kiss for me, that I'd hit the mark.
Come on.
That I mean, is that wild? And I still have them today. They're in a little sack of velvet sack on my desk. They're precious. But honestly, they were etched with these etchings. And it was on Good Friday morning, of all things, with the cross. I mean, yeah. So that was the beginning. And then, yeah, through the years, he's had me do others relating to martyrs in England and Germany and the Reformation, a lot of it. So, yeah, he does confirm it through time.
Wow.
And he can confirm it in other ways. And throughout all my journeys, I would journal. I've journaled everything all these years. I have 15,000 pages of handwritten journals. Or I journaled all my journeys to document what God was doing.
Wow, 15,000 pages.
That's right.
Oh, my goodness. So how can people stay connected with you, Gary?
Okay. My ministry is Transformation Glory International. You can find me at transformationglory.com. You can write me at gary@transformationglory.com or visit the website. I'm on Facebook as Gary Beaton. You can find me. I'm on Instagram under Transformation underscore Glory, Transformation Glory. And I'm on YouTube. I have my own YouTube channel with some of these stories.
So people can hear more of the stories.
Yeah, okay, good. Gary Beaton.
Mm-hmm. Good. And then have you written any books or any of these?
I'm in the midst of writing my first book right now.
Okay, awesome. I know we're all looking forward to reading it.
Thank you.
This is going to be fascinating. So thank you so much for joining again today.
Yeah, thank you, Caleb, very much.
Yeah, so those that have been listening today, we honor you. Thanks for continuing to be a part of what the Lord is doing through this podcast and through this channel, Awaken the Wonder. We bless you guys today. Go forward today in the joy of the Lord. And if He's stirring you, make sure you take a step of obedience today into that journey. In Jesus' name. Until next time.
Thank you for listening to Awaken the Wonder. If you enjoyed today's show and want more ministry like this, please visit kingdomencounters.us, where you can find weekly blogs and my latest book, Hunger. Be sure to subscribe and follow me on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram at the tag Evangelist Caleb Wampler. If the Lord leads you to partner with us in the nations in prayer and giving, visit kingdomencounters.us. I'll see you next time.